$1,000 or more in Bitcoin being moved?
No, we're talking about the UFO.
I thought you were talking about little green men.
Yeah, we're talking about the UFOs.
No, that we are now. We're talking about UFOs now.
Well, UAPs or whatever.
Well, thank God that Bitcoin solves everything, so we know that even if we are under attack, we will be fine.
You missed our earlier conversation, Eric, where we were saying that what if because of like convergent technology solutions, that when aliens do arrive, that they also have a proof of work based Nakamoto consensus currency, and what would we do then? Would we call them shitcoiners? Would we like longest chain wins? Like, what would that adversarial fight look like?
First of all, let me just say one thing: if you were faced with the awesome power of aliens, or even God himself or herself, I have no doubt that the Bitcoin community would start off asserting that they were a shitcoiner.
100%.
Yeah. After that,
have fun staying poor, aliens.
Have fun staying poor, aliens. That's very funny. Then there's the issue of the double spending problem if time is multidimensional, which all I know is that Bitcoin solves everything.
Unless it's faster than light.
Well, that's the issue. I mean, is it really faster than light? If you have an Alcubierre warp drive, what does it mean in some sense to solve the double spending problem?
Eric, these are the right questions.
Guys, if they have FTL messaging, that's just a new opcode in Bitcoin. We got this. It's done. It's easy.
It's a simple fork. Soft fork.
To be honest, all of these crazy stories are starting to merge together inside of my mind. And given that I'm four drinks in the evening, I'm not positive that I really should be here opining about anything. But I am curious to hear, what do you guys make of UFOs and Bitcoin?
Well, I think the reason, if there are aliens and they haven't contacted us, they're waiting for us to fully hyper Bitcoinize, and it's like, okay, now you have your shit together. Hey, welcome to the universe. That's what will happen.
No, I think that Michael's right.
They didn't jumpstart the process.
This is sort of like in Star Trek, where they won't meet another culture until they develop warp drive. I think that's probably exactly correct, Michael.
I think that, to Eric's original point, it's definitely going to be, we're going to all meet up, and they're going to determine whose chain is the right chain, and we'll just accuse each other of being shitcoiners until, you know, someone screams loud enough, and then it'll be done.
Here's my question. Is Satoshi human?
Well, there is the theory that Satoshi is a time traveler.
Wait, first you have to answer, are you human? And we need you to prove it.
I am all too human, as my wife reminds me almost constantly. But I'm somewhat serious that all of these crazy narratives are seemingly unresolved. So we have an unresolved Epstein narrative. We have an unresolved Satoshi narrative. An unresolved Wuhan narrative. An unresolved UAP narrative. The sheer awesomeness of the number of unresolved narratives begs the question, are these things going to converge in some interesting way? Your thoughts?
Hold on, Eric. Do you think that all humans are responsible for the majority of technological innovation?
Well, it's an interesting question. I do believe that the innovations that post-date the biological innovations are generally speaking understandable. Even something like the Antic Theorem mechanism as an analog computer of celestial bodies. I think that most of them make pretty good sense. I don't feel a need to invoke radical.
One of my favorite theories about aliens being sent among us is that Bill Gates is actually an alien. And every time a society gets close to the singularity, they send a shock troop down to create the most prominent operating system so that selectively crashes in order to decelerate our singularity into collapse. And so we're accelerating too quickly. The blue screen is the limit function. It's flattening the curve so that we can evolve emotionally into the technological singularity, and that Bill Gates is saving humanity.
This is all
It's like a three body problem style situation where really the aliens are just getting ready to harvest us for all of our resources.
Eric, to your question about unresolved narratives, I've sort of had the same thought. Like the number of unresolved narratives is increasing, but I think that's because we're no longer accepting the explanations for them. Like if you go look back at history, there's a fuck ton of unresolved narratives. You know, like the entire Trump era is an unresolved narrative, for example. But apart from that, like, you're right, Epstein and everything else. I don't think that there's a convergence on them. I think that all we do is end up moving towards a world where no narratives regarding the state ever get resolved.
What about JFK?
Yeah, that too.
Well, I think in a weird way, this issue of unresolved narratives gets really intense starting with Cuba and Batista and Castro, the missile crisis. Then it goes through the JFK assassination, Watergate, the bizarreness of
Venona papers,
9/11.
And through this weird through line, it more or less has been going a pace for 60 years. And it does feel to me that like Cuba, Watergate, and the JFK assassination are going to at some point wrap up when we no longer need to deny whatever the heck that was.
The Titanic sinking also.
So wait, we don't think that's just because... Wait, but we don't think that that's just because this is the epoch that we are existing in? Like, I have to imagine, like, that every person who was in a tumultuous time had a similar experience. Like, you don't think going into, like, World War One or World War Two, people were like, oh my gosh, there's so many unresolved narratives.
I think there's a very weird way in which we can't confront the fact that our time is different because we have a Copernican bias. We have an idea that, of course, everyone has always felt everything. There is nothing new under the sun, that this is always an arrogance that people believe they live in special times, they have special problems. This is sort of an anti-narcissistic hedge, if you will. And because we are choosing to hedge away the specialness of our time, we are oddly in a position in which we don't recognize how special this time is. Nobody has ever fused nuclei on the surface of this planet in thousands or millions of years. And we live in the time in which we have people who, within living memory, remember the first atomic fissions and fusions. I don't think we're being responsible. I think taking the Copernican perspective, Bitcoin, by the way, is an astounding innovation. And I think, you know, roughly speaking, we've lost the ability to recognize when something truly momentous happens.
I'm putting a note down here in my notebook. Eric says I should be more narcissistic.
Actually,
I like that point, though.
I'm not kidding about that. I do think that in part we've developed this fear of anyone leading. Everything that looks like leadership reminds us of Hitler. Everything that looks like genius reminds us of hype. Everything that looks like kindness reminds us of a disingenuous ploy to open our purse strings. Like, we weirdly don't believe in almost anything. And I do think that in part, like things like codependency are positive. They link us and they force us to have to deal with each other and not to separate. And I do think that narcissism has its place. But I think what we've done is we've pathologized everything that has moved the human story forward. And I think it's an actually fascinating question of why is it that we have taken these very strong normative positions against all sorts of things that have shown themselves historically to lead to human progress.
Well, everyone in this room strongly believes in Bitcoin.
Eric, let me ask you, what brought you into the room?
The desire for abuse. It's been a while since the Bitcoin maximalists have decided that I was the devil incarnate. And I wanted to renew our relationship. Because I know that all I need to say is that...
I need someone to make fun of me right now.
Exactly. Gauge theory fixes everything, bitches.
I actually, on the point of gauge, I have a response on the physics side, which... It's based on just sticking to statistical mechanics, thermodynamics, and the idea that we don't need to get into this theoretical particle physics, or I don't know how you'd categorize it. I don't know physics, sort of. I'm just an engineer. But the way I formulate it is that money can be thought of as information, and that when you have the capacity to change the money supply, it is akin to deleting information. And therefore, Landau's principle would indicate that that is going to cause an increase in entropy. So from that, I'd say that you need to preserve the money supply in order to minimize this entropy waste. And Bitcoin is the only way to do that, and proof of work is the only way to do that. So Bitcoin is actually an energy minimal system to run a civilization.
That was beautiful. It may even be true. I don't know. I would say this about the gauge theory aspect of it. Gauge theory to me is different than what it is to many of you, which is just the way you were just saying, Bitcoin, you know, that money is information. Gauge theory is just calculus. It's just differential calculus. And it's differential calculus with one special property. So I didn't view it as like some magical, mystical thing to impose on the community. By the way, I should totally develop a shitcoin and make billions of dollars. But that really wasn't my intention.
Would you call it gauge coin?
I'd buy it. Where do I buy it?
No.
Apparently the punishments for doing that are like paying a little check to the SEC. So
okay, well,
we'll be punished.
But the issue is that just to revisit it, in the early 1990s, we had sort of decided that markets were intrinsically gauge theoretic. And the whole goal that we were on about was how do you take the freedom away from economists to do funny, you know, games using the rate of inflation or the money supply. So one of the things that's really interesting is that the Bitcoin community shares my hatred for a small number of professors getting around a table to try to figure out what the rest of us are supposed to believe. And I was on this for a long time from a very different perspective, which is that we needed honest systems of national accounts, you know, growth accounting, inflation accounting, what have you. And Bitcoin came much, much later. So I think people have heard that as, I just found out about Bitcoin. That's one of your favorite memes. And I'm here to fix it. But that's not really what it's about. It's about very long-standing interest in shutting down the ability of a small cabal of economists to pull the wool over all of our eyes. And I view one of the reasons I'm so interested in crypto in general, distributed computing, and Bitcoin in particular, is that it's an extremely successful, different kind of a hack to take this power away. So that's why I keep hanging out with you guys, and I keep taking your abuse because you guys think that I'm coming after you when in fact we were years and years in front of you and very happy to see you guys. So I'm super happy to be contributing to a pro-Bitcoin attitude and a pro-crypto attitude during a slide because, you know, this is a ridiculous way to evaluate this genius idea. And then when you guys are going up, you tend to be total fucking dicks. And, you know, you say number go up. But my point is, if number go down, I'm not gonna crap out. And I'm not going to crap out just because there's an abusive quality and a toxic quality. This is the most important, most interesting thing around. And in part, I want you guys to succeed despite yourselves.
To be honest, we like you more than Elon, for the record.
Wait, say that again?
We like you more than Elon, I think he said.
Oh, but you didn't. but you were so in love with Elon. It was so sad.
I know, but can we pick a higher bar than that?
What? I don't want to rebound with you. I want to nurse you back to health and decide whether this is a reasonable relationship that you actually want to be in. I just want to say how pathetic it was that you guys fell for that hairline and that strong jaw. It breaks my heart.
I will say, Eric, but I have found your contribution.
His rocket is so big, though. That's the thing, Eric. His rocket is just so big.
You know, the thing about it is that it's the girth of the rocket that really matters, and I feel like you guys got taken in by length.
Yes.
So Eric, in the spirit of the room, I was wondering, do you yet have a lightning channel open, and could we help you make that happen?
Yes.
Yeah, I was going to say, is he on Plebnet?
I should say that I have been thinking about, let me just be honest with you guys, although I notice that always goes terribly with this community, but I don't get smarter. Look, honestly, the whole point is to get off this planet, and I thought Elon was trying to do that. And I'm now a little bit worried. I couldn't really understand why Elon would do what he's doing. It certainly doesn't make sense to me that what he's doing is through rockets. If you're really trying to get out of the solar system, rockets isn't the way to go. Physics is. So this whole issue of Elon, Bitcoin, rockets, aliens, really matters to me. But on the other hand, from such an idiosyncratic perspective, which is, I really want to re-engineer the physical universe, and I want crypto to be part of that, in part because we need to abstract the laws of physics into the digital realm. Now, please, you guys can write a million Medium posts or Substack posts saying Eric Weinstein is crazy, but it's not really that crazy of an idea. We have to realize that the double spend problem is effectively a conservation law, and that the world of physics is the only system we know that never throws an exception. And we should effectively engage in something like biomimicry, but with physics, with our currencies, to make sure that what we do is to create something new that effectively powers our search for a viable solution for humanity. If we stay on this planet with the people who are this dumb and this powerful with thermonuclear weapons and viruses and all this kind of stuff, we're toast. So really the thing I was hoping to do with the Bitcoin community was in part try to figure out how do we fund a physics renaissance to get us the heck off this planet, not rockets, not the solar system, but the actual cosmos, using this amazing innovation of Satoshi, whoever she or he might be.
It sounds like you got taken in by Elon.
Me?
Eric, you should come on Clubhouse drunk more.
Well, Eric, it's been very obvious for many years that Elon is doing nothing but scamming people. I was livid when the Bitcoin community fell enamored with him. And when they fell out, I was livid that the Bitcoin community gave a shit what he thought. Like, he's been a scammer since the beginning. His accounting is bad, which I would think a person who's mathematical like you would have understood. Yeah.
No. There is this issue about sales. By the way, you know, there's also an issue about anybody who pushes anything at the moment is going to be accused of being a scammer. And I think we should
That's not true.
Okay, say more.
But like, there's people that are legitimate and people that aren't. Like, you can kind of identify people that aren't legitimate pretty quickly. I think Theranos was a great example of this. If you knew anything about physics, you would very quickly have known that Theranos was a scam. And that's the case with a lot of this stuff. I mean, like, you're on like Vitalik's dick. You like Ethereum, for example.
Wait. Say that again. I'm on Vitalik's dick.
Yeah, I speak in
can I just ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm a 55-year-old guy. Can we not talk like this?
No. I talk like this.
I won't talk that way. I'm sorry.
Yeah, let's have a conversation without that then, because like there's like so many other ideas that don't have like revolve around men.
Because let me just be honest with you. I'm feeling really frustrated. I'm not really a meme guy. I mean, I made a joke out of memes with the distracted boyfriend.
Eric, I encourage you not to get caught up by like the guys that are going to get your attention most. The reality is I love Junseth, and Junseth is going to try to troll me when I come up with an idea too. So I didn't.
No, that's not true. That's not true, John, at all. That's very discounting of me, by the way. No, that's extremely. She's a terrible investor.
Yesterday she was the worst, and now she's terrible. So I'm glad she's made some progress. She's the worst.
Shut up. Like that's ridiculous.
That's not fair.
Guys. I get to say
my piece. You guys can say yours. I'm not going to insult you as you make your points.
Point without him saying. You could have made the same point without.
Oh, John, I get to make my points the way I get to make my points. You can do it when you're talking. You can make your.
You won't get anywhere in the conversation. But keep going.
Thank you for the lecture. You enjoy things like Ethereum, Eric, and like I look at a lot of the stuff.
You enjoy things like Ethereum, Eric.
You asked me not to say you're on Vitalik's dick, which
But why do you? But again, this is such low-level shit. Why do we talk like this?
Let me finish. You praise Ethereum, you praise Vitalik, and those are very clearly things that provide no value, not in this space and not outside of it.
Okay. Well, then once again, I'm just the guy who doesn't get it. But, you know, there we are.
Oh, but explain why.
We can have a productive conversation in good faith without being, you know, adversarial. I think we can keep a non-adversarial tone when we discuss, even if we disagree.
Well, the conversation
that sounds
was
great.
Eric
Let's do that.
Saying, conversational Eric conversation. That he wants to go to off the planet, right? And that's what his interest in Bitcoin was, to try to fund a renaissance in physics and find new physics.
Wait. Let me say it clearly. My interest in Bitcoin is very, very different. Okay. Bitcoin is many, many things to me. One thing it is money. And I think you guys have made that abundantly clear that part of its value proposition is not being too many things to too many people. I really appreciated that. I really learned something from you as a community. Another thing that Bitcoin is a major technological innovation. And the idea that it's not simply money nor simply a technological innovation and is a superposition of these things and is going to lead to a conflict. And some of you guys are going to say, no, you don't understand. It is money. That's what makes it brilliant. And others of you will say, no, you don't understand. It solved this problem. That's what makes it brilliant. Okay, so we can have that argument in perpetuity. But maybe the idea is that the meta perspective is that that argument is what's functional. Assume that that's true. Put it aside for a moment. You have this opportunity to port the physical universe digitally into a world which has problems with things like abundance. Abundance is a scourge, and scarcity is genius, right? Creating scarcity in a world of abundance and saving us from the terror of abundance is something that many people in Silicon Valley did not get, which is one of the reasons why Silicon Valley weirdly wasn't as hot to trot for Bitcoin and crypto as it should have been. Right, because it was in some Burning Man haze about abundance is good, where effectively abundance kills markets and markets give freedom. So I do think that for one thing, we haven't had the super serious intellectual conversation that settles this. I want to say something else. Remember that abuse is fun. It's fun to be abusive, but most of us recognize that abuse is not something that's easy to sell. So when you have an idea that you're under attack by people who don't get it, are horrible, you entitle yourself to abuse because abuse is a fun thing to do. And I think that part of the problem is that people in the Bitcoin community aren't in touch with the difference between two very related concepts, one of which is we have to defend this community rather strongly against people who would exploit this and not understand the particular beauty of Bitcoin. I think that's a very interesting proposition. And to the extent that I look like a pathogen, I appreciate the immune response. On the other hand, there's a different way in which it's just an opportunity to talk one's book and be abusive at the same time. And that's a very different thing because abuse is fun. I think it's really important to try to elevate the conversation. But if you guys don't want to, if you want to go back to the thing we tried before, we can do it. I have other things to do. It doesn't mean that I'm going to change my mind on Bitcoin. I'm pretty pro-Bitcoin. I do think that the community could afford to, how do I say this in French, fucking grow up when it comes to understanding who your actual friends are, who your enemies are, who is a fellow traveler but not necessarily part of the community. But if you guys don't want to do that and you just want to say number go up, okay, say number go up.
I agree. I think that's a solid point.
I think a lot of people actually are willing to engage on some of these things, but unfortunately, a lot of people are not super articulate about why things do not appeal to them in the same way. For instance, I personally like I don't like to pile on necessarily with the, everything that isn't Bitcoin is a shitcoin. However, there is a kernel of truth to some of those lines of reasoning, and most people are not well enough educated to be able to articulate them in full and quickly. And furthermore, even if they did have the ability and willingness to do so, sometimes being too willing to do so in too many different circumstances can create essentially a denial of service attack on many of these people's time. So, now, like to your point, right, being able to distinguish between those who are genuinely trying to learn and those who are essentially like trying to denial of service attack or troll with trying to gain this information in order to maybe make whatever other project more public or more legitimate than maybe it actually is, that sometimes people can't really tell the difference. And I think a lot of people are kind of waking up to this, even within the Bitcoin community. But, you know, sometimes, you know, people can be in bad moods, et cetera. And,
I appreciate that. But let me just say it very clearly. Who defends you guys when you're down, whether or not you treat them well, right? At some level, I'll be blunt about it. I haven't really changed my mind about much. I've always been like wildly enthusiastic about this thing. And there's no amount of shitting on me that you can do that's going to change that, because it's actually about what it is. Right.
I appreciate the basedness of that.
Yeah. So, yeah. But you know, here's the thing. It's really important that you not, if you guys are going to at least walk your walk, don't get fucking sucked into this Elon mimetic shit. You know, it's like,
this guy, we're all done with that now.
Well, I appreciate that you're done with that now, but my point is, don't do it at all. Don't do it for the next person. The next person who
Great
point.
To your point, you said that you recognize that scarcity is an important part of what we're doing here, and I think you're right. So why is it that you recognize, like, or why is it that you support these other shit coins? Like, why, like, what value do you think that's it?
You support these other shit coins. I assume this is because I've heard
you say stuff. So, like, I'm asking a question. I think it's, you can, like,
Wait. But let's have a real conversation about it.
Sure.
The first question is, do you support these other coins? Not shit coins, not with the denigration. Just like, what do you think, Eric? And the answer, to be blunt about it, is I don't know. You know, at some level, what you guys have taught me, and I listen to you even when you guys are insufferable.
And this is the opportunity to educate, Eric. And so, like, this is where I was kind of shifting. And so to the extent that you want to have these conversations, because Keegan was just, you know, and I agree with it, you know, jokingly, I started a what's now become a embarrassingly popular Sunday morning program here where we create space for quote unquote altcoiners to help them understand, you know, whether or not they've been scammed and whether or not they understand whatever coin they've gotten into and any improprieties behind it. But Keegan kind of highlighted that there is a pattern to this, and we'd love to, like, help you understand why there is such a specific component around how we view it as a shitcoin. And, you know, we can start with Ethereum, by the way, which is the most notable of these things. If it's something you're interested in trying to help
understand
where we come from.
Let me tell you what I've heard from you guys so far, and you just quickly tell me. By the way, the other part of this is the last thing I want to do is to have something happen in Bitcoin space, which is like, Eric Weinstein showed up and took over the room. Because, like, I'll just demote myself to the audience and listen.
It's totally fine.
We're happy to have you.
No. Just
I've been very interested into a room for that reason.
Okay, just wanted to do the hygiene thing. Here's what I think I learned from you guys the last time, which didn't need to be done in this way that you guys do it, but whatever. I think what you told me is that the QWERTY phenomena, the path-dependent phenomena around Bitcoin, is singular and will never come again. And that as long as we don't find out that Satoshi is China, or that Satoshi is the NSA, or Satoshi is something, you know, Jeffrey Epstein, horrible, we have this weird story in which, bizarrely, the founding of Bitcoin is its singular gift. And the fact that it's not trying to be too many things to too many people actually means that we are lucky that whoever invented this could have done it from the most narrowly exploitative and extractive fashion possible. So far as we know, that isn't actually how this thing started. And I don't know what the origin story is, neither do any of you, or probably neither do any of you. And in that world, we have to recognize that the path dependence of Bitcoin is, in a weird sense, what distinguishes it from everything else. Now, do I have that more or less correct, just first approximation?
Well, it's not
quite
just...
The beautiful part about that is that it really doesn't matter who made it and why. The fact is that the incentives to support it are so strong. And as someone in the room said on Twitter, like, what's really the issue is that the money is broken, and Bitcoin's the only opportunity that we have to fix the money. And once that's done, we can work on fixing all the other problems of the world, because the incentives and just the fiat system are so jacked up.
But ultimately, yes, you're correct, Eric. That is a fairly valid
Bitcoin has a certain immaculate conception to it that is entirely unrepeatable. However, I actually think that that is a far less salient point than the fact that the fact that Satoshi is gone now, right? If Satoshi was still anonymous but still around, then that gives credence to the fact that there is a leader to this project. And in many ways, even though we have various members that might have a little bit more influence than others, there's this sort of revolving door in Bitcoin about who has influence at what time, whose ideas get listened to at what times. And because there isn't this sort of founder entitlement, the way that a lot of the other projects run, there isn't room for anybody to claim ownership over the idea that is Bitcoin. And we've seen this happen in countless occasions outside of Bitcoin. Like, you know, you have Craig Wright with trying to even claim that he is Satoshi, but pretty much every other altcoin project has one or maybe two people who can, even through soft influence, essentially outright control the protocol. And you can even see that with Ethereum today. The foundation makes a regular habit of hard forking the protocol every so often, despite the fact that hard forks are backwards incompatible and are forced upgrades, right? This is something that's notably absent within Bitcoin culture. And it's in large part due to the fact that the founder is gone.
But I also think
the foundation also sold 40,000 Ethereum at the peak of the market last week. That's the Ethereum Foundation just dumped their bags on everybody.
That's but I also think
Satoshi, most likely.
I also think to your point of there being like a mimetic overreaction in terms of like the antibodies in the community is very true. A lot of what happened with the big block, small block debate was very contentious and very toxic and hurt people in a way that they don't even like to talk about. And I'm wearing a UASF hat. That was a form of signaling for consensus that undid that contention. But to this day, because of that, the thing that this community is the most sensitive to is notions of denominationalism and denominations. And so I did a lot of thinking about, because I went to Catholic school growing up, I was thinking about the theological discussions about, is denominationalism in and of itself an inherent good or evil when discussing a canon? And what you see is that after 2017, 2016, with the user-activated hard fork and the big block, small block debate, there was a radical shift to an overreaction sort of in the mimetic antibodies for this idea that denominationalism is an inherent bad that must be nipped in the butt as quickly as possible because we don't want it to be like it was last time. And I think it's actually sort of the current strongest weakness of the community is the is that dial is at 11 right now. It's not at like 7 or 5. No,
I think this is a really, really well phrased. If I could just say one thing about that, it feels to me from as an outsider, that in essence, what's going on is that there's an extra thing that is necessary, which is something like culture, and that the culture of a leaderless society is necessary to shepherd this thing so that it's not constantly attacked by, let's say, egoic coins. I don't know how to put it, but this issue where the founder becomes an important part of the coin. It's sort of a similar, if you will, to like the role of Guido in Python, you know, the dictator for life, the benevolent dictator for life model. And if you like Singapore or you like Python, maybe the idea is that you're going to like Ethereum because Vitalik is there. I don't know. So I do understand the need for a radical culture and a culture that is, in particular, one of the things I love about Bitcoin culture is this thing I call the relationship with the unforgiving. It's like Bitcoin, like honey badgers and poo, just is, right? And it doesn't have a boss, and it doesn't care what you think. And, you know, facts don't care about your feelings, and feelings don't care about your Bitcoin. I appreciate that kind of coldness and hostility at the surface level, and then the fact that you guys are actually very often socially focused below that hard, crusty exterior. So there's lots of interesting things that I've learned about the idea of needing an oral Torah, if you will, to shepherd through the protocols. The fact that you guys have some type 1 and type 2 error programs and that you have a ready, fire, aim sort of an approach to outsiders is understandable. It doesn't really bother me that much in general. It just, in when you have somebody who's trying to say different things and they get misinterpreted, it just wastes a lot of time and energy.
But the point is, everyone can say so many different things, and that's irrelevant because it doesn't change what Bitcoin actually is, because it'll keep going. So no matter what personalities are in it, Bitcoin's just going to keep doing what it's doing because more people will buy it.
It just is.
Can we move back into Ethereum, I just want to mention that Bitcoin Twitter is not Bitcoin. Bitcoin is decentralized. Bitcoin is for everyone.
Yeah, you guys, I no also one can think
hear.
That there's
just for the record, everybody thinks that everyone's hearing, but like literally no one can actually hear anything. So hey, Jonathan, if you want to jump in, and then D++ and Keegan, if you have some thoughts. I don't want to run the room at all, but I was just going to say that I
like to focus on opportunities of commonality rather than distinction. And so to that end, I think it would be amazing to have a conversation about Lightning, your beliefs on that, and how we can get you more involved with that, or how Taproot might change things more so than it is about how we differ on different protocols or things that won't add to the conversation, like, sure. Add to moving forward.
Yeah. For me, here's what I would love. In part, a bunch of you guys have reached out to me privately and personally saying, hey, I'm a member of this community and I think we got things slightly wrong with you. Would you like to be leveled up? And basically the answer is hell yes. And, you know, the thing is that it's most important to me to get the world back excited about crypto. And that's why these tweets that Bitcoin. I keep coming out with, in part because I'm because of your bad behavior, I'm weirdly in a position of credibility to say that this is really important because it has beaten up on me. So it's a weird thing because in the lack of understanding of I of you and you of me, I have some opportunity to say, hey, don't shit on this thing. This thing is amazing. And if you guys want to level me up with Lightning, understanding the deep technology and the philosophy and all that stuff, super eager to be a student. Let me just say the one thing that I would really like to do. I would like to focus you guys that Bitcoin does not yet know how to solve everything, and that I'm really focused on the existential issue of making sure that humans are a spacefaring civilization beyond the solar system. I'm talking about post-rockets. And to the extent that governments are failing and that centralized structures are failing, honestly, I look to you guys. And I think what you don't understand is how much respect I do have for this community and the wealth it's generated and the wisdom and all of these things. Because when I talk about physics, I really am talking about humanity and an escape plan so that we're not trapped on a single planetary surface with multiple madmen with access to thermonuclear weapons and the ability to engineer viruses and the like. So to an enormous extent, I really hope that those of you guys who are money freaks, and I am not a money freak, would get together and try to figure out a plan for, just as we protect ourselves from central bankers and their evil printing presses and the ways that they wish to use them, saying words like stimulus or rescue or relief and all this nonsense, which is actually dilutive and transferring of wealth without consent. What's really important to me is that you guys take on the role of adults and understand that physics is dooming us right now. And physics is also potentially our salvation. And Elon has a lot of wisdom. How he figured out rockets and Mars, I don't think I understand. It doesn't make sense as a plan. Just as the way his crypto stuff doesn't make sense. But what I'm really looking to do is I'm really looking to say, hey, are you guys ready to be the people who might fund the next accelerator after the LHC, who might fund research programs to save all of our bacon? And once you get past, you know, hodling and Lamborghinis and all that kind of fucking
Eric,
shit.
I gotta ask you, because I feel like what I'm hearing you say, and I don't even actually disagree with a lot of it, is I feel like I'm hearing that you want a place to come learn in a credible way, and you feel like in terms of knowledge and ethos that we share that, and you feel like this is a place to learn. And then I also hear you doing kind of a maturity check, which, you know, sometimes I find myself doing too, in terms of like, is this community ready to take on the challenges that it says it's going to fix?
Are you ready to be grown-up pirates? Yeah, I'm looking for grown-up pirates, okay?
So can I say something about Bitcoin fixes this? So you mentioned that we're focused a bit on the money and you'd like to kind of think about other things that we need fixing. But I think Bitcoin fixes the money. And in fixing the money, we kind of fix everything else just kind of by default. So in fixing the money, we de-incentivize war. And Bitcoin drains the power from the war machine. It makes the world a peaceful place. And in making the world a peaceful place, that makes us able to become this multi-planetary species. So we really do have to fix the money first.
I stated a little bit differently, actually. It's like money is the best tool that humans have invented to incent cooperation. It is, and human cooperation is almost the only thing that we have as a civilization, right? It's the thing that basically allowed us to go from not like, you know, just what every other mammal was to the civilization that we have today. And so insofar as we can get that right, and even still, like Bitcoin has a lot of work to even finish getting this right, right? Like a lot of people in this room and on Twitter and things like that, they think that Bitcoin is kind of like it, that in its current state, it will just sort of, it is its divine right to take over. And I'm very heavily on the side that like Bitcoin requires the stewardship of all of us to make sure that we all collectively get it right, because there's still a chance to fuck it up. And well, I think in large
that's what
parts,
I was talking about, right? Because I mean, ultimately Bitcoin, as D++ mentioned, it's the seed, it's the beginning. It's what's going to bring us to those other things Eric's talking about. If we have centralized, you know, governments fail and everything that's centralized, to go to a decentralized world, you need to have the money first. And that's the seed. And if you don't have good stewardship of the seed, what's going to happen? Is it really going to grow and blossom?
Well, can we connect it back to what Eric said about space? My view as someone who is of the view that Bitcoin fixes everything, it's that by looking at any angle of whatever is important to you in the world, if you follow that all the way down, eventually it leads to Bitcoin. But we can start with one thing in particular, and I might be uniquely suited to answer this because aerospace actually is the thing that brought me to Bitcoin. And I'm not sure of anyone else, that, at least that I've met, that has had a similar path. I was developing advanced materials for aerospace, really enabling layer technologies and looking at
Peter
the financial
Todd, maybe.
System around that.
Bitcoin fish.
So my point is I was on the absolute bleeding edge of the most advanced things, where if you want to make the highest performance race car, rocket, whatever, you're going to need to use the stuff that I was working on. And it's still in its infancy in terms of commercialization, but that was why I went into Bitcoin. And what I would say is what I was explaining earlier before about the energy. It's that with fiat, we decouple every action we take from that base layer energy, and that all human activity is manipulation of energy. If we look at any good or service, there is an energy cost associated to it. So what Bitcoin does is it forces us to find the minimal energy solution. And this isn't just mining, it's everything. And that by reducing the energy cost, we make a machine more efficient. And a machine in sort of a general sense. And that increase in efficiency allows its greater consumption through Jevons paradox. And I would posit that this is the fundamental mechanism by which civilization can grow. And Bitcoin allows this base layer growth. And that is what is needed to have a civilization that can do the engineering to get to this next layer of physics. I was just in a room yesterday where people were asking, what is the new physics that we need to do the interstellar travel? And I was saying, hey, you know, there's a lot of materials and manufacturing that we need to be able to do, tinkering level stuff, where there is a lot to be gained. For instance, a rotating detonation engine. That's not something where someone is going to have a new mathematical theory and then suddenly we have it. That's a lot of trial and error. And I think that sort of base is what is needed to support a spacefaring civilization. I think the problem when we get into the stuff with Elon Musk and going to Mars is it's trying to take things in too monolithic of a way, just making the really big rocket, getting there once. But when we do that, we are not actually advancing all the layered components. So we're building that on a weak base, and I don't think it's going to sustainably lead to actually having a civilization on Mars or beyond.
And that's what I think Junseth was saying originally when he was kind of being a little trolly with his language.
Not at all.
He was saying, just with the language, but that's just Junseth. It grows on you. But saying that Elon was a scammer, I think that's what you were getting at, right, Junseth?
Yes. And that followed up with, you could have known.
I mean, but, you know, to some extent, you know, aesthetics precedes ability, right? So I remember one of the NASA engineers, when they found out that they needed to get to the moon, said, all right, what the hell are we doing? And in the strategy session, they said, well, I read this really good Arthur C. Clarke novel, and it talked about a three-stage rocket. Maybe we should look at that. And, you know, talking about like how Bitcoin is going to be the way that everyone on Earth pays for things back in 2009. I think is no more sort of a vision or an aesthetic that precedes the ability to do it than Elon saying he wants to go to Mars in relation to his current capacity to do so.
The thing that's so fascinating to me about that specifically is that there isn't an example. I guess what you're saying is that that is the sci-fi sort of imagining of the world that we all want to live in. Is that right? The narratives that were...
Well, I mean, at some point... At some point, like, inspiring change in the world is almost indistinguishable from a delusion insofar as it's only time that tells whether or not it manifests, right? Because it's like every great change is almost delusional in its reach until we find out that we actually can manifest it.
Got it.
The one thing, too, that I've talked to Jeff Booth about this when he came on my podcast, and Eric, if you haven't read his book, The Price of Tomorrow, you really should. It's an awesome resource. You should talk to Eric Booth as well. You should have him on your podcast. I mean, Jeff Booth. But Elon benefits greatly from fiat money and the Cantillon effect and the money printer. Like Elon funds his companies through central banks printing money. And we all know that that doesn't have a net positive effect. Well, we kind of get the feeling it does. Like that doesn't have a net positive effect for humans in general. Like that we get extra technology, we get technological advances. But like Michael's saying, maybe the excessive money printing allows us to discover new technologies or maybe get to Mars, but on a weak base, where something like Bitcoin with a monetary standard that's doesn't give someone the ability to weaken everybody else's value and savings and steal from everyone else on the planet so that the top spenders get the most benefit. Like maybe that's a better system, but we don't really know because we've never really run that experiment. And would we have gotten to Mars on a Bitcoin standard versus a central bank money printing spree that we're on right now?
Well, since we share a mutual distaste for fiat currency, let me just say a few things about it. Maybe the right way to view fiat currency is as something like the webbing between your fingers that you don't see because it was apoptosed, right? So you're trying to get rid of certain things as scaffolding. Maybe the idea is that the purpose of fiat currency was to produce real money, and real money's purpose is to facilitate escape from a certain death situation. However you want to do this, I'm down with the project. What I'm ultimately focused on is, as you all know, Bitcoin doesn't solve everything. It doesn't solve the problem of a broken heart. It doesn't solve your child having a rare disease. There are all sorts of things that Bitcoin does not yet solve. And the facile nature of the community is okay. It's a compression of a really deep philosophy. I really think you guys are onto something incredibly profound, and that in a weird way, it finds itself expressing itself through memes in the way in which something profound would express itself through the mundane. This is basically the technique of bathos. What really I want to focus on is not the morality tale of who uses fiat and who accepts the goodness of Bitcoin. The real issue is these are all instrumental, and I guess I don't know how to pronounce D++'s name, but I'm just going to say it as D++.
That's correct.
You nailed it.
Okay. You know, the issue is to what end? And I'm very clear. Like Elon and I share a tremendous, Junseth, you may want to view me as a scammer as well. Everyone's a scammer. There we go. You know, to me, I've more or less devoted an enormous chunk of my life to one theory that may be wrong. And that theory is the only thing that I know of that has a real possibility of getting us the hell off this planet if it isn't UFOs. Now, I don't know, in some sense, how we go forward, but I know that people who are trying to invent the future are always going to encounter violent opposition, which is what you guys have been up to, and it's part of what formed your culture. So just think of this as a very different solitary project where instead of an entire community, there's just one person shepherding this thing called geometric unity. And the purpose of it is to make sure that we have options so that we don't all have to stay here. Because frankly, I don't want to stick around with Vladimir Putin, Joe Biden, and Donald Trump. I think this is a recipe for disaster. Idiots with thermonuclear weapons is not a good idea. And you know, in essence, what I want to do is I want to find out, do we have something to do together? If we don't, I'm happy for you guys to go along on your own. If we do, maybe Bitcoin does fix everything. But it's a very genuine, I don't know a way of being genuine with you guys, in part because every sensible person wants money, because money is freedom. But it's not a play. It's just a question of when you're ready, when I'm ready. If there's something to do, let's fucking do it. If not, go do your thing. And the one thing I would ask you is please don't chase people like Elon anymore, because it's disastrous.
Eric, it's so true. It doesn't make someone a scammer to be either orthogonal to scammers, or to, you know, it doesn't make Isaac Newton a scammer because he chased alchemy his entire life, right? Like, that's not what that means. The reason Elon is a scammer is because Elon makes a fuck ton of money by repeating lies and pursuing things through nefarious means, such as, you know, bad accounting. That's a very different thing than pursuing something that could potentially not work. That said, really, can we please talk about Ethereum? I would really like.
Yeah, yeah. I don't understand this idea that I am a Ethereum supporter, a shitcoin supporter. What the fuck is this?
Well, do you like Ethereum?
What do you mean? Do I like Ethereum?
Is it something you find interesting?
I find Ethereum interesting.
What do you find interesting about it?
I find interesting that it is moving beyond the simplicity of Bitcoin. I find Bitcoin interesting in part because it rejects chasing multiple goals.
Well, that's first layer. Like, it has to scale out like the internet scales out, like the TCP/IP model. So
let's let Junseth talk to him.
Yeah, Eric, I mean, I think that it's important to note that early on in Bitcoin's history, there were a lot of people that were talking about doing things like smart contracts on Bitcoin. The reason that Bitcoin didn't do it isn't because it wasn't a good idea. It's because it was inadvisable. Like, very smart people thought about this for a very long time and thought, you know what, if you do that, you increase the attack surface, it becomes hackable. If you do that, it's going to cause huge problems with chain weight, which Ethereum does. If you look at Ethereum's security model, there's a huge amount of value on the chain that isn't actually accounted for in the security system of Ethereum. And like, these were the reasons that Bitcoin didn't pursue that. And now, as Bitcoin has advanced, there are actually ways to do everything Ethereum does on Bitcoin. Like rootstock is a good example. And that will continue to be the case. The only reason Ethereum exists is because Vitalik, who was a child and still kind of is, was willing to do something that was completely inadvisable and has proven inadvisable by the number of times that it's been hacked and money's been stolen out of these smart contracts.
Well, let me just say this. I am open to the idea that everything that can be done through some other crypto thing should be done through some extension of Bitcoin. and that you guys have accounted for. I don't know enough to have those opinions, right? So I know where I am. Like, the weird thing is that somehow I don't think that I tend to speak wildly beyond my pay grade, but I think many of you assume that I am asserting things wildly beyond my pay grade. So just based on what
this,
you just
by
said...
By the way, this was my assumption.
Okay.
Yeah.
Junseth, what was your assumption? Just say it clearly.
Exactly that you tend to come into these places, Bitcoin in particular, assert things that are beyond your pay grade and credential as a means for having people listen to you.
So let's
I could be very wrong, and I apologize if that was my assumption.
And by the way, if I'm very wrong, I apologize in advance, because how irritating, right? So I think that what happened was very, very different. If I can just, in 30 seconds, try to say it, I think the idea is that I have a very old idea from the early 1990s about any kind of currency will be engaged in a gauge theory, because gauge theory is just differential calculus, and differential calculus will always be enmeshed in markets, right? So that was sort of the original idea. It wasn't a question of, I could have invented Bitcoin or anything, or I'm going to go invent gauge coin or anything like that. So I think that there was an initial sense of what I would call snap-to-grid thinking, where you look at somebody who's just invaded your space and you say, oh, we've met this before. And I don't think you actually had met me before, but I could be wrong about that. Maybe I'm just doing the same thing everybody else is, and I'm, narcissistically thinking that I'm a special snowflake different from all the others. Then there's the issue of the idea that there is voodoo and there is philosophy and culture around Bitcoin that is markedly different than every other alternative. And I think it's actually interesting and fascinating. And I do think that it gets a lot of power in part by, how do I put this? By trying to be, I do think that the singular ideology of Bitcoin coming from this mysterious situation is either a great danger when we actually understand who Satoshi was, or the great savior of Bitcoin because it has a story unlike anyone else. And then the question is...
That doesn't matter, right?
What?
So I think that's what I think before, and I'll let anybody jump in on why that point actually is somewhat...
Can we just let him finish, John?
Yeah, please.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
All right. So sorry. So based on the idea that it has a singular origin story, I believe that a culture has cropped up to take advantage of that origin story in a non-exploitative fashion. And I do believe that there's a weird way in which the people who torment me and cause me to lose slight amounts of sleep, although honestly not that much, are defending something worth defending. And that's one of the reasons why I wasn't in full attack mode, because I didn't want to actually hurt the community. I saw the community as trying to do something noble.
And I don't just think one individual can hurt the community.
Pardon me?
One individual can hurt the community.
No. Well, fair enough. I mean, I don't want to exaggerate my own importance, but I do see that the problem with number go up is what happens if number go down, and I would like to eliminate the dependence of number go up and number go down on where we think about Bitcoin. I would like people to take this thing effing seriously.
Eric, I do think that the number go up meme is something that Bitcoiners created to make fun of shitcoiners. Like that's mostly what that is. It's not really something that most true Bitcoiners give a shit about.
Yeah. So the origination of number go up was because a lot of the altcoin communities would try to make fun of Bitcoiners as like saying that the only thing that we do is watch the number go up, and that we aren't interested in innovating in any way, shape, or form. Which, if you spend,
I did not know that.
Literally any time, if you spend any time on the Bitcoin dev mailing list, you'll know that it is a very busy place, and it's almost a full-time job just to keep up with the developments that are kind of constantly being proposed and sort of rejected, accepted, developed, etc. within Bitcoin.
In fact, I think we would assert that it's the only one of the alt or crypto coins that is interested in innovation and true innovation. And I'll give you an example.
So, privacy coins. In response to that, it is a very common trope. In fact, this is something that you should pay attention to, because it's not the last time it's going to happen. Bitcoiners tend to own the criticisms that are advanced upon them by altcoiners. One of the other ones here is toxicity. Toxicity, the toxic Bitcoin maximalist archetype, was actually born out of Vitalik's criticism for the Bitcoin community, calling it toxic. And they were just like, look, we're on a mission. We're trying to solve something. You're getting distracted. And yes, we're going to own this toxicity. So it is not uncommon for us to end up sort of absorbing some of these criticisms and turning them into our own, like, positive.
Well, I love that.
Keegan, the Bitcoin toxicity was there when Counterparty and MasterCoin existed. It does most certainly predate Ethereum.
Apologies for getting it wrong, but I think that the spirit of what I was saying is still correct. No?
Junseth is the father of Bitcoin toxicity. Thank you. I will take that.
So I think you're learning a lot, and Eric, and I would encourage you to do this. I think the conversation should persist along this line to the extent that you're still interested in having it. I heard you say, you know, if we can work together, let's do it. Let's fucking go. But if not, then, you know, let's all go on our separate ways. I would encourage you instead, perhaps bring some nuance to that perspective, simply saying, yo, there's some people here. I think I'm understanding a little bit better, even if in this conversation or a couple of days ago when we were chatting in the afternoon. I think that I would encourage you, now that you're getting a better handle of, like, I think the information that's coming at you, the tone and it, you know, and somewhat the genealogy of it, like, I would just tell you that perhaps it doesn't have to be so black or white. Perhaps you can go on a journey of coming to a place that you can actually learn about things like Ethereum and things like, you know, why Bitcoiners have such a, you know, quite frankly, repulsive response to shitcoin scams. And so my take on it, you know, is perhaps a little bit of nuance and not necessarily such a binary approach, if in fact that is how you feel. Because I think, you know, whether it's the Bitcoin community that turns its back in some cases where it can perhaps help someone to, you know, not see or be blind to what is obvious to us in some cases, and if not almost all cases, to Keegan's point, to be scams. And so if only just the consideration of just like, hey, listen, man, let's talk about it. Let's learn about it. Because I do think there are some gaps in your knowledge, admittedly and otherwise, that I think would help, you know, to advance a discussion on whether or not, to your goal, it does make sense for these communities
to work on
something. So let's drive the conversation a little bit too, because I think Junseth is really helping to drive some of the conversation around Ether that actually I think translates to a lot of other criticisms we have for a lot of other shitcoins, as we call them. But Junseth, do you want to jump in on that?
I'd like to hit on the development portion, Eric, just because I think this is important. The reason that, like, we talk about things like we're the only ones interested in actual development, a good example of this is the privacy coins like Monero or Zcash and such. The Bitcoin community is very focused on, you know, privacy. Right now, like, everything is completely public on our ledger, right? This is one of the big criticisms of blockchains. Also a thing that people sometimes, like, governments like it, right? You can see everything. Bitcoin really does a lot with privacy. There's actually a way to do ring signatures in Bitcoin. It's called a coin join or mixing. And the reason that we haven't implemented any of these privacy schemes on Bitcoin is because the core devs and the mailing list, which is basically a Socratarian argument forum, is where basically we've realized that none of these methods actually will scale. Like, blockchains are a giant common, what do you call it, it's a
fully replicated database.
Well, it's not just a tragedy of the fully commons. Replicated, it's a commons, and if you don't manage your commons, you end up with one person having all of his goats eat all of the grass. And the reason we haven't implemented privacy is because we haven't found anything that is scalable. Well, now there are some things that are on the horizon. I think Taproot contributes to that initiative, that strong signatures and such. The reason that they're being implemented that way is the new privacy, and they're the two actually scalable to do it. That tends to be the overarching ethos.
Is just having a robot?
You're breaking up real hard.
Yep. Bad connection, Joseph.
So what Junseth was saying is essentially that the privacy developments, some are on the horizon, such as Taproot. It switches up the signature scheme from ECDSA to Schnorr signatures. And later on, there's something that can be done called cross-input aggregation, essentially, which allows kind of like an anonymity set based on the script itself. It's like a pay to Taproot script.
But I think I think the taproot thing, though, can't be understated. So, like, the problem with most security schemes is that, or privacy schemes, is that it's always opt-in, very few people use it, and it's less convenient and more costly. And the funny thing about Taproot, unlike all these other protocols talking about things they want to build, it works. The only problem with Taproot in it right now is there's a meta debate about how to activate it in a way that's consistent with no one being in charge of Bitcoin. That's the only difficulty with Taproot right now. It's sort of like a legal argument where the argument before the court battle is the argument at hand. But the cool thing about Taproot is that it's going to be, I think, the greatest form of financial privacy that's going to occur in modern time, because any type of structured transaction is indistinguishable from a standard transaction. So in the very near future, every Bitcoin, and the thing that makes it ubiquitous is that it's actually orders of magnitude cheaper to do. And so people will be able to let their Bitcoin be public and anyone can look at it, or they could use Taproot and actually obfuscate it and pay 90% less on their transaction.
So I think, like, just to dumb it down for a second, I think what Junseth was trying to get to is that all the quote-unquote innovation you're seeing on other altcoins, most of the time, it tended to just be a copy of Bitcoin, and they removed all of the safety features. And Bitcoin goes much slower and develops probably all the same stuff over time, but in a safe manner. And that's really the difference.
I would add to that, the biggest
Ethereum specifically in this regard, the Turing completeness that they often report as a feature is a bug for precisely the reason of, like, undecidability, right? One of the things that is necessary in order to keep the Bitcoin network from being denial of service is to be able to very intrinsically understand how transactions are going to affect the network and thus the validation. However, we lose that when we let Turing completeness into the scripting language, at least in the normal case. And what that ends up meaning is that you don't really get the analysis ability of any of the stuff that you're doing anymore. And that's true of Ethereum. It's true of anything else that touts Turing completeness.
And then compounds, right?
Download the entire thing on your node.
We could absolutely add an opcode to the stack machine in Bitcoin that would make it Turing complete. However, this is well understood to be a not good thing.
Yeah, it compounds with their account model versus Bitcoin's UTXO model, as well as any block being rewarded. They call it uncles. And then on top of that, the negative externalities in the network for even, running your own node. You can't do that. They'll come up with things that say, it's a full node, but they refer to it as an archival node in Bitcoin. We're calling it full node because it's fully validating node. It could still be pruned. So there's these little nuances that they try to trick people.
They play worksaw games.
Exactly. And then ultimately,
Eric, is some of this stuff making sense, by the way, in terms of like the views that we have? It's because it's one thing when we're comparing like stocks with Ford and GM and trying to help a family member understand it versus telling someone.
I can't get all the details not because I'm too dumb, but just because a lot of it is inside baseball.
That's why I wanted to slow it down.
No, totally great. The way I would say it is, you're saying things that sort of have a feel to them, which is like, geez, we're trying to be the adults in the room to save the world, and everybody who's got some sort of bright, shiny little gadget that they can put on the basic technology is trying to convince you to buy their thing, and we've rejected all of these things for a reason. We're a community under active development, and we have this problem that every time somebody starts to learn about this, we can tell where they are in their intellectual progress by what linguistic mistakes they're making, what the wrong exactly things right that they say. I can tell, so you don't understand this, you don't understand that. And then you guys are in some sort of super painful situation where you're like, okay, so now we've got somebody who's been playing guitar for 3 weeks telling John Petrucci what he should really do if he really wants to shred, you know?
And yeah, pretty much exactly that.
Okay, so let's assume that I get that, and I've been past that for quite some time. What I want to do is to say, you guys are going to have a continual problem. Let's imagine that you're Ray Charles fans and that Bobby Darin has a version of What Did I Say that is going out to all the white kids, right? And you guys are saying, oh my God, that's only cool because Ray Charles did it and he did it a million times better and you're not getting it. Okay. There's some process where you need to streamline. You could almost be like a wizard. If I think this, click here, you know, because effectively what you guys are going through is you're going through Groundhog Day with every new person who makes the same set of mistakes. And then
it's actually every pump cycle, every time Bitcoin pumps, then thousands of people come in and do that.
Great. So the problem is, to be blunt about it, well, let me just permit me one arrogance. I don't think I was who you guys thought I was, and I don't think I'm going to be who you guys think I'm going to be. I don't think that my relationship to Ethereum is what you think it is. I don't think that my relationship to fiat is what you think it is. If I wanted to say what I really fucking hate about this community, it's that you guys have a problem you haven't identified, which is snap to grid. You've seen so much 100%. Over and over and over again that you snap people who don't belong in a grid into your grid, and then you let the sort of the... let's call it gracious toxicity, work its magic. Now, the reason I'm here is that I never bought it to begin with. I think you guys are actually a bunch of fucking idealists. And I think that in your idealism, and maybe you're even the grown-ups in the room. Wouldn't that be weird? So assume that you guys are idealistic grown-ups who are actually engaged in something that works. I'm down for that. And I'm also not up to telling you what you guys already know. I do know a few things. One thing I know is that if this is a serious form of money, it's going to be taking place in a gauge theoretic context. You guys can't get out of it. I can't get you out of it. Money is going to end up in gauge theory. Second thing, all of our notions of inflation and national accounts are broken because none of the economists know how to do that stuff actually. And it's very important to me that we bring next level understanding of markets into the new economics that's set to replace neoclassical economics. We share a common goal in disintermediating central bankers, of making sure that people's life savings can't be inflated away, and giving people an escape from the horrors of fiat-inflicted dilution, or seniorage, whatever you want to call it. So with all of that, I want to say the following. I want to get off the stage. I desperately want your help. I want to help you in any way I can. If you guys want to do the old thing, we can do the old thing again. It's not going to sour me on Bitcoin. What I really want to do, though...
even today, don't you, though, Eric? Yeah. I mean, I think the reality is we're having a conversation now.
And well, but you're also having a conversation when, you know... I don't think we'd be having a conversation if the exchange rate was at 70,000. I don't know.
I would tell you that actually, I think for someone, you know, and I don't want to speak for everybody in the room, because I do think that's one of the things that I struggle with sometimes, is that, like, I do think there is, and I don't think your representations are wrong of the things that you've highlighted. I think that we all could see some forms of that. But what I would tell you is I actually don't think that would matter. I really genuinely think that I'm speaking for most people on this stage, that even if we were at 100K, this conversation would be something that would still be persisting, I think, in the way that it has tonight. I'd encourage you to continue that.
Well, let me stay with me in the conversation.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So what I would say is, I think that you guys would want to have the conversation. I think we wouldn't be able to get there. I don't think it's because you guys change when this thing goes down. I think it's because level, you know, the weird thing is that you want to know who's an interloper. Like, why am I here if this thing is down? Why am I not taking a victory lap? It's because I don't want to do that. I believe in this technology. I believe in new money. I believe in a new world. And I do think that in part Bitcoin is perfectly positioned to lead. So, you know, the reason that I'm here...
Do we lose him or is that me?
What?
No, I can hear him.
Oh, sorry, keep going.
Yeah, all right. Go ahead.
The thing is that the dip, which I believe will be reversed before long, and long maybe 5 years, I don't know, but it doesn't matter to me. The dip in the exchange rate affords us an opportunity to see who's serious and who's just fucking around. And what I want to say is I really appreciate that both of us are taking the opportunity to redo things. Now, what I want to say is here's my ask.
Wait, I want to learn. One sec, Eric, because wait. There is no Bitcoin community, and there's going to there be is toxic a Bitcoin people community. On Twitter.
Thank you, Brad.
But this is an important thing, yeah, Eric, because very important. There's been so many of us that have been trying to engage with you in a completely respectful way, empathetically, yeah. trying to engage intellectually.
No,
I'm just saying this is not just you, but a lot of people that come into the space. But unfortunately, it's the people that are toxic and that are being memey and that are like being the most controversial that end up grabbing attention.
Let's not do that. Let's agree that there's a purpose to the memes.
What's the ask then? And like, well, that's what I think you were driving at.
Yeah, the ask is the following. One, I would like to be treated as a student who is going to make several mistakes that are canonical and other mistakes that are non-canonical. And I want to be not snapped to grid. That's the thing that fucking, I can't stand it. Is it somebody,
Eric, can I get a word? Wait, one second.
Right? So the whole idea of like, if you love Ethereum, like that kind of statement, I just sit here and say, I don't really have any feelings about Ethereum. But I don't hate Ethereum, that's true, because I don't know why I should. Now, if I should hate it, that's one thing. If not, that's another thing. What I want to do is I want to be your student. I want some recognition that I may have something to say about money or gauge theory or whatever, and I may not, and that's okay by me. And I have an ask, which is, right now, the most important thing for me is to figure out whether or not I can shepherd geometric unity to do anything. Now, if the theory isn't right, so be it. Then it's, you know, some crazy thing that occurred to me. If the theory is right, I'm going to need to marshal capital, brains, all sorts of things to actually operationalize it so that we have some hope of not being under the tyranny of Einstein's general relativity and quantum field theory. Now, I don't know what that means. I know that it's going to require some amount of money, brain power, but more than anything, I feel like you guys are the rebels. And I'm looking for the adult community of pirates, people who both want to break the rules and be outside of control, but who want to form a strong social positive culture that takes responsibility in part for the people that we don't necessarily get along with, the normies. We are going to have to take care of the normies. And I don't know how to be an adult. I've never seen it done by people older than me. And I'm trying to invent this, and maybe I'm doing a terrible job of it, but more than anything, what I would love to do is to figure out, is there something to do using the power of the Bitcoin community, its brain power, its financial heft, and the fact that you guys are generally rebels. I appreciate that you don't think of yourselves as always being of a community. It's decentralized just the way that Bitcoin is. But what I really want to do is I really want to push humanity forward. And I don't know how to do it, and I would love the help. And I really appreciate you guys welcoming me in. And I don't mind joking around about this stuff, but educate me. Just the one thing I beg of you is recognize I'm also trying to save, to solve everything. And what I really want is I want not to be snapped to grid, because that's the thing that turns me off and causes me to become dumber than I would normally be.
So Eric, here's what I would encourage, and to the extent that this matters, or the extent this is helpful, I would encourage you to equivalently not let the, I think, like minority of voices to do it. Because I think Brad, and feel free to jump in here, I think, and Victor were trying to explain this point, is that in its decentralized nature and in its, quite frankly, growth to what it's become, there, it's really been the stepchild. And I would, like, you know, 95% of the conversation, as you can probably tell today, has been pretty good exchange, right? With perhaps one or two things that have turned you off. And my fear is that one or two things may keep you from actually, perhaps if your goal is aligned with ours, or if in fact, perhaps your theories do become, or are able to come to fruition, whether it's the capital you seek or the brain power or just the community alignment and rebellion that you bring up, I would encourage you not to be deterred by, you know, some voices in that process.
And
Brad, why don't you jump in, and Victor, feel free to highlight that point. I would encourage you to keep that focus, Eric.
Eric, there is no we or the Bitcoin community. There's people on the stage I don't even like, and it's all like bottom up. Like
there's a community. There's a cult. There is a cult, and I'm the cult leader. And, you know, we're centralized in that regard. No, but I'm joking.
This is all true.
I'm joking.
No,
but here's the thing. Bitcoin, you're right. Bitcoin, it pushes humanity forward. And I believe that it paves the way to solve all the problems of the world through fixing the money. And I'll kind of explain how I think that. But I think I like what you said about Bitcoiners being idealistic. And we absolutely are. We are optimists, maybe with the exception of Junseth, but we love Junseth. And
I'm an optimist.
Are you an optimist?
I'm just not a libertarian.
Okay, so you're an optimist. Great. We need optimists in our world. And I think we're able to see a vision of the future.
We don't need optimists. We need definite optimists, people that actually do stuff.
Totally. And we see a version of the future.